help us with our service.
Thank you, Dale. You might have concluded that, may not be, cut my mic off. You might have concluded that Hope did vote to call me as the pastor because I am here and not having brunch at this time. So I am very happy to be here, and I can attest to the hard work of your search committee and the diligence and the care that they put into it, as well as the welcome and love that they put into it. So I'm surprised they announced it before they got to meet me, because now they know who to thank or who to blame at the end. So, so as we gather here for worship today, I invite you to join me preparing your hearts and minds for worship in our responsive call to worship. Come, gather in the presence of the one who is love and compassion.
We come bringing our hopes and dreams, our hurts and fears.
Come, knowing that God is already here with us.
We long to share our joys and sorrows, all that lies.
Rejoice as we worship the one whose love is always with us.
We rejoice as we worship God, whose compassion holds us all.
Please join me in our opening prayer. How wonderful to gather here with each other and with you, O God. Fill our worship with the wonders of your love, bringing joy and solace where needed. Through our time together, bring us closer to the heart of Jesus. May your light shine on us now, so we may share it with others when we leave this place and place. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
But you arise as able in body or spirit, and join me in singing our first hymn, number 505, Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Thank you.
Our scripture today comes from the book of 1 Samuel. At this point in Israel's history, Israel is still being overseen by the judges. There is yet to be a king appointed. And there is starting to be some distress in the land. And during this time, the temple is not even a vision in anyone's eyes, or Jerusalem. And so worship for the Hebrew people are taking place in Shiloh. Shiloh was where they built the tent of tabernacle, and then they housed the ark that contained the Ten Commandments. And so this was a place of yearly pilgrimage for everyone. And so that is where we start today with our reading in Shiloh. Let us listen for God's voice speaking through these words. There was a certain man from Ramathan, a Zuphite, from the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, son of Jehon, son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, and the son of Zuph, an Ephraimite. He had two wives. One was called Hannah, and the other, Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none. Year after year, this man went up from his town to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord Almighty at Shiloh, where Hophni and Phinehas, the two sons of Eli, were priests of the Lord. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of meat to his wife Peninnah and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion, because he loved her and the Lord had closed her womb. Because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked till she wept and would not eat. Her husband Elkanah would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons? Once, when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli the priest was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the Lord's house. In her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly. And she made a vow, saying, "Lord Almighty, if you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head." As she kept praying to the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. Eli thought she was drunk and said to her, "How long are you going to stay drunk? Put away your wine." "Not so, my lord," Hannah replied. "I am a woman who is deeply troubled. I've not been drinking beer or wine. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I have been praying here out of my great anguish and grief." Eli answered, "Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him." She said, "May your servant find favor in your eyes." Then she went away and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. May God add a blessing of understanding to our hearing of these words. Thank you. pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts and spirits be inspired by your Holy Spirit and thus made pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. How many of you can recall the Verizon commercials with the tagline, "Can you hear me now?" They depicted a cell phone tech traveling all over the country through waving grain fields into snow-covered hills, in city streets and in offices, all the while on his phone asking the person on the other end if, well, they could hear him now. It was a brilliant marketing move for the time, for cell phone technology was still relatively new, the coverage areas were sporadic, and so those who had phones dealt daily with calls that either were so staticky they could not hear, where every other word was garbled so you couldn't make sense of what the person was saying, or other times when the connection would drop 20 seconds before you stopped speaking. At the time, sometimes just moving even just a few feet could cause the connection to drop and for the person to start saying, "Can you hear me now?" It seemed like a daily, if not hourly, experience. Now, the pandemic has offered us another experience that we can have this question asked, to experience that frustration in Zoom meetings. Have you ever been in a Zoom meeting and realized that someone has been speaking for the last 2 minutes but has forgotten to unmute themselves? I'm sure none of you have ever done that yourself, and I know I haven't. Whether it's a dropped communication or having left myself muted, I become frustrated if it happens too much. And if it perseveres long enough, I tend to give up trying to get people to hear me and understand and just move on. I doubt if anyone could blame Hannah if that's what she was feeling in the beginning of our reading today. Actually, she's beyond frustrated. She's heartbroken. She's been living with the pain of infertility for years, unable to bear children for her husband Elkanah, while his other wife Peninnah has already given him sons and daughters. Nothing can console Hannah. It doesn't matter that when the family makes the yearly pilgrimage to Shiloh, Elkanah gives her a double portion of the celebratory meal, or that the rest of the year, he sincerely tries to reassure her that he loves her dearly and that this doesn't matter to him. But the monthly cycle of hoping that she is pregnant only to have it crushed has broken her spirit. She has broken her emotionally. For she knows that others around her are looking at her with scorn, for in the time that she lives, a woman's worth is tied directly to being able to bear a child. Some are probably also condemning her, as it was a common belief that if a woman was barren, it was because of some great sin or wrong that they had committed. On top of all this, it is evident from today's reading that no one is hearing her pain. They hear her words, but there is a tremendous gap between taking in those auditory signals and being able to recognize those words and understand it. And Hannah repeatedly faces this gap. Her husband Elkanah isn't hearing her. This is evident in his bumbling attempts to try to console her, professing that his love should be enough for her. Because after all, isn't he worth more than 10 sons? As one commentator I read this week said, whether she said it to him or just thought it, Connor's response was, "No. No, you're not." Preacher Margaret Copenhaver suggests that for Hannah, that comment lands like the well-intentioned but sometimes hurtful advice given to us. To count your blessings or look at what you still have when you are right in the middle of being grieved or feeling overwhelmed. Hannah might also be thinking that that's easy for you to say, Elkanah. You have what you want. His needs for being a father are already met with Peninnah's children. So he is viewing this from his perspective, his word, not hers. Still, let's not pick on him too much, because Elkanah cares enough that he does dote in his own way on Hannah, doing at least what he thinks will make her feel loved and worthy. And then there is Peninnah. One might think that since Peninnah knows from her own personal experience how much her status is tied to bearing children, how much her future security will rely on having a son who can take care of her in her old age, she would be empathetic towards him. Instead, Peninnah uses her own children to taunt Hannah's infertility. Perhaps Peninnah is jealous of the obvious favoritism that Elkanah has been bestowing on Hannah. After all, Peninnah is the one who has provided for his legacy. If anyone is to be favored, surely it should be her. And so Peninnah closes her ears to her sister wife's pain, choosing instead to increase Hannah's distress by reminding Hannah that in their society's eyes, Peninnah has succeeded and Hannah has failed. And so on one pilgrimage to Shiloh, it becomes too much for Hannah. Once again, Elkanah offering her a double portion of the meal only highlights the differences between Hannah and Peninnah to all who are present. She doesn't have any children who he could serve that second portion. Hannah's grief is so deep, she can't eat at all. She's inconsolable. And so after dinner, she seeks the solace of the tabernacle temple, established for worship and housing the Ark of the Covenant. She passed by the priest who's sitting at the door, perhaps not even seeing him there, as she comes in and pours out on her knees her prayers to God of grief and pain. Even as her voice remains silent, her frantically moving lips reveal the grief, the pain, and probably the anger that is held in her heart. A few moments later, Eli, who is the head priest and also the judge over Israel, enters into the tabernacle. He discovers on the floor this overwrought woman bent over, her mouth moving, but no sound coming out. Rather than ask, "Are you okay?" he immediately concludes that she is overindulged in the wine at dinner and demand that she take her drunken self out of the sacred place. Surprisingly, for a woman of her time and a woman in this state, she perseveres, refusing to leave or let Eli's judgment stand. She tells him that he should recognize that she is actually praying, not drunk, pouring out her heart to God, all that it contains. And for the first time in our reading, it seems like she is heard, at least a little bit. For Eli responds with the words that are translated in our reading, "The God of Israel grant the petition you have made to him." In the original Hebrew language, it's unclear whether he is making a promise that God will answer her prayer, or whether he is saying that he is hoping God will answer her prayer. In either case, at least her pain has now been acknowledged by Eli through his words. And then a miracle occurs. And though she will eventually give birth to Samuel, who will grow into the prophet that anoints, at God's request, the first two kings of Israel, that's not the miracle I refer to. Samuel's birth is important in the wider story of God and the Hebrew people, but that is a story that we can explore hopefully another time. The miracle for Hannah is more immediate. For Hannah now knows that God hears her prayer, that God has recognized her sorrow, and that God is with her, no matter whether she has a child or not. So she can return to Elkanah, not knowing what the future holds, but in peace, to share a meal with him, and then perhaps get the first full night's sleep she's gotten in quite a while. Commentator Debbie Thomas describes what happened with Hannah that night in this way. Hannah refuses to be comforted by anything less than an encounter with the divine. In a religious culture that sees her barrenness as a curse and a punishment for sin, Hannah walks boldly into the temple on her own terms, essentially declaring that her plight is neither her fault nor God's curse, but rather an occasion for profound sorrow and long lament, an occasion that breaks God's heart. No half-baked comfort, no religious cliches, no priestly rebuke can deter her. She weeps and grieves and pleads until she is spent. While calling Hannah's silent yet emotional lament the rawest and most elemental form of prayer, UCC theologian Walter Brueggemann contends that when Hannah lifts her despair and tears in prayer, her expectation is not that she will receive a child. She hopes that God answers her prayer in that way. But that is not her expectation as she enters into the tabernacle. Brueggemann believes that through her prayer, Hannah expects to be heard by a real partner in anticipation of a real response, even if that response is not the child she hopes for. She pours out her heart, expecting that not only will God hear her words, but will hear and respond not only to her heart, but from God's own heart. It is that expectation that her prayers will be heard by a real partner in anticipation of a real response that leads rabbis and theologians such as Brueggemann to hold Hannah up as a model of prayer. It is her willingness to bring her raw feelings to prayer, to cry so hard and so earnestly in the presence of God, so that Eli mistakes her as someone who abided a little bit too much at dinner. Far from regretting Eli's chastising, Hannah comes to prayer broken and distraught, expects a response from God, and then leaves, knowing that God is not only with her, but that she is carried in God's heart. Hannah's pleading emotional prayer reminds us of the promises of God shown throughout Scripture, that we can bring our deepest emotions confide in our hearts to God and know that we have been heard. We also know that we will be responded to in the same way that Hannah was, from God's heart. We can know that God hears us, caring about what we lift up in prayer, as well as us. So whether it's through the formal prayers that we have learned throughout the years, the raw and emotional prayers such as Hannah's that we see today, or those prayers that are so deep within our pain or our joy that it moves Paul in Romans to write that they can only be prayed by the Holy Spirit, who intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words. Whatever the form of our prayer, we are reassured we will also encounter God's presence with us there. These past few years have provided ample opportunity for raw and elemental prayers, occasions where we could lament boldly. There is COVID and all the others that show up on our news shows and our social feeds too frequently, so I don't need to list them here. And there are those more intimate ones, such as Hannah's, that occur. My husband's parents died 6 months apart from each other before the pandemic, followed by my own parents' death within 10 months of each other as a result of COVID, were two such times for my husband and I. And when I allowed myself to bring out of that pain my stripped down, vulnerable prayers to God, even if I couldn't feel it at the time, I came to know more often than not that even when I can't feel it, I am still held in God's heart. And that is where God wants us to bring our laments and grief to reside, squarely with God's own being of love. What are the times, the places, the situations in your lives where you've needed to pray like Hannah, raw elemental prayers, so deep that they seem to come from your very being? The good news is that like Hannah, we can bring those times, those situations and people to the one who will not only encounter us there, but will stay present with us. The good news that even in the worst and most dire circumstances, we can encounter the divine, whose answer will always be filled with love for us, even if it's not the answer that we want. We will meet the one who will stay with us until we can leave there in peace and assurance that we are held in God's heart. Like Hannah, may we always find that place when we are in need. Amen.
Thank you.
our hearts in prayer. I invite you to share through joys or concerns that you would like lifted up in the company of all of us today. Then let us pray. Gracious God, we come to you this morning grateful for all the times we experience your love, your presence in our lives and our prayers. Whether our prayers be filled with joy and celebration or filled with questioning and discernment, or like Hannah's, filled with tears and grief. You promise that you hold all our prayers in your heart, surrounded by your love, your compassion, and care. Hear us now as we lift up some of the places, the situations, the people that we hold in our hearts, humbly trusting that they are already in yours. The ongoing pandemic, the accompanying uncertainty of whether the coming months will be ones of increasing improvement or another surge, prolong our sense of being off balance and unsure what to do. As a result, some live in fear, others in anger, others frustrated, and many in some combination of these. Remind us that no matter what, you are here with us, offering us ways to live within this time of uncertainty, as well as the ability to do so. We cannot even begin to list all the places in our world, in our nation, perhaps even within our own relationships, where divisions are widening and giving lie to the idea that there exists a them and us, and that they are to be feared or they are dangerous. Bring the power of your reconciling spirit between all of us, so that like Jesus, we see each person as your beloved child, no matter what our differences. Show us the ways to reach across those divides that reflect your love, justice, and reconciliation. After this worship service, we will enter into a time of decision about the joining of this congregation, Hope UCC, and myself on the next steps of our journey. We do so in humble hope that we've come to this point through our desire to follow you and your ways to the best of our abilities, and in anticipation of the yet-to-be-recognized possibilities you have ahead for us all. We know there are many who are hurting, O God, in body, in mind, or in spirit. Surround them with your love and with your peace. Grant the doctors, the nurses, and all the staffs and people who care for them the gift of compassion towards them, as well as compassion towards themselves. And for those who grieve losses, whether they be recent or from years ago, continue to remind them that you are present in those tears. Continue to remind them that you are with them and leading them to the day when once again they will be able to envision those glimmers of joy and hope that even now exist. Holy One, we lift up all these prayers, as well as the unspoken ones of our hearts and spirits, in the name of Jesus, joining together in the words Jesus taught us to pray. Amen.
our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand as able and join me in singing our final hymn, 519, Not My Brother, Not My Sister. Congregational meeting after the service. these past few days with you and with Hope, and as I spent time with the search committees in August, I am so impressed by the welcome that I have received and by the love that they have already shared with me. I am hoping that the vote is positive. I don't know what I'm going to do if it isn't, because I felt like I could go out to brunch instead of doing something at home. But I'm confident that no matter what the decision is, and I expect it to be yes, please be yes, that God is in it and that God does hold us already in God's heart and care. Please join me in our benediction. Rejoice and remember, God hears our prayers no matter how or if we pray. The Spirit draws us closer to God and each other, no matter the challenges we encounter. And the grace of Christ encompasses us, no matter where our journeys lead. May God bless you and keep you until we meet again. So what's next, Dale?
We'll have you
wait in the office.
Wait in the office.
Okay. All right.